Michael? Michael.
Are you been able to make?
Yes, fantastic.
So what did you think then?
My only feedback is I could have watched much more.
Well, that's the thing, you know, it's better you end up with a feeling like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still a case of the Greenland film was actually longer. That's a feature because the earlier ones, how should I say? At that time, the idea was that an hour was, you know, kind of maximum.
Sure.
Now it's more people, feature is for movie, and then the shorter version is for TV. With TV, there's less patience and so.
For sure. It's just, it's an amazing view and sight into all of these adventures. It's just, it's very captivating, and I find it very, and especially at a time that we're at right now with COVID-19, you're home, you're not out, and then you get to have this opportunity and watch you as you're exploring at different times. So it's, I think it's a great, it was a great launch to be able to do this film festival now at this time.
That's good to hear. Yeah, it is indeed the oddest of time, but of course we in Sweden here are, how should I say, a little bit different. Because we are still allowed to be outdoors, like me and girls, we've been to the forest, and as I told Matt, it's full of people. We all think, yeah, normally there's no one there, but now it's like people realize we just have to take this opportunity until the day the government start enforcing rules. If this is happening, I don't know. I hope so far we kind of trust the government and the institutions. Swedes are very much like that, and we didn't connect a lot even before. We are not a huggy, welcoming people as such. So it's not that. Not that big difference, to tell you.
Fair enough. And hopefully for you that it won't get to the extent. It's going to be a very different long weekend, I think, for everybody here, not being able to be with as many family members and what have you, for sure.
Well, we've got Dave. We've got Dave on video.
Dave, he's somewhere in the bush now, isn't he?
Dave, you're muted. You have to unmute.
You're unmuted.
Do you like it, Michael? Do you like it? I'm growing it just for everybody.
Well, I'm going for the same one, you know, a bit. You look good, Dave.
You as well, brother. You as well. I miss you like crazy. I miss you.
Same here. It's amazing that it had to come to a virus that actually connect like this.
I know.
All right.
We will do it again soon.
We will. And I'm happy to see that you look healthy and well. And
Thank you.
You're somewhere outside Toronto now.
Yeah. I'm in British Columbia. It's beautiful here. Soon, we'll bring you up. You'll love it.
Well, let's see how long it will take, mate. But hopefully, I think it feels like, at least from a Swedish perspective, that it's kind of balanced, and it seems like we are under control. But you never know. We'll see.
Exactly. Exactly.
All right. So it is noon now. Sorry to interrupt the small talk, but I'm going to hop right in. Thank you all so much who have dialed in to listen to the live Q&A. I really hope you guys have had the opportunity to watch all the films, if not all of them, at least the most recent one, which is the one to Greenland. Looks like Dave's video froze. Can you guys still hear me okay?
Absolutely. Yeah? I just turned the video off to okay, not distract awesome. People.
Perfect. I know your beautiful face is very distracting sometimes, so we appreciate that. But yeah, so anyways, Mikael Strandberg, if you guys aren't familiar with him, you are a little bit more now. I'll give a quick intro. Mikael is our most seasoned explorer in residence. He's been an explorer in residence with us for many years now, throughout all the making of these films. And he's been kind enough to not only share these films with our entire staff, but to also do this live Q&A with us, which is going to give us a really unique opportunity to chat with Michael about the various themes of his films, the experiences that he's had when making them, and a little bit more about who he is as a person and as an explorer. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Michael to give a little bit more of a background on himself and on the films.
Wow, that's, well, the films, I've done 7 films up till date. And to tell you the truth, I was never looking to become a filmmaker or anything like that. It just happened. Let's see now. So I decided when I was 11 or 12, I started to read Jack London and books like that, and it kind of opened a completely new world for me. So books are important. And I'm brought up in a small village in central Sweden. It's very similar to a small place in Canada. And my parents, they were kind of, as we say here, simple working people, very little education and so on. But we had these 3 books that my dad stole at the library, so we would look more intellectual than the neighbor. And one of them was Jack London. And I one day I was ill. I think it was another virus or something. And it opened my world. So I started traveling. And after a while, I decided I really wanted to make this into a lifestyle. But I've also realized, you know, opportunities tend to just turn up. And the same applied to when it came to how me starting to film. I've done these 3 big bicycle trips, 6.5, 7 years. And after the second one through Africa, somebody from Swedish television called me up and said, why don't you bring a camera on your next trip? Which I did, and that's how it started. I had a lot of unhappy people watching it from the beginning because my Swedish accent is like a hillbilly accent, still is. So I got a lot of abuse talking like an idiot, still get that today, a lot of that tough luck. But that's how it started. And it's developed. And then, you know, I had a success 2006, this Siberian journey, which is after, 16 years later, it came on back onto Swedish television yesterday. And it was a huge success back then and is still working well. So it's kind of the circle is done now. And Jeff Wilner and Kensington came in 2010 or 11. We had a big argument because I was looking for a job as a tourist guide. Wife was pregnant with Eva. The girls are in there yelling or doing some game. So we didn't get along, Jeff and me, initially. And then he suddenly invited me to come to Congo Kinshasa. Such a Jeff move. So I ended up there. Turns out, what a lovely fella, met Andrew at the same time. Andrew, I've completely forgotten his second name. What's his name? Maddie.
Andrew through Orgut?
Yeah, yeah. Wonderful, Andrew. And so it kind of started there. So Jeff and Kensington was part of the first Yemen film. And then it's just grown and gotten bigger and gotten bigger. And this last Greenland film has been a huge success. I was really, really worried because it's, you know, I'm talking about my wife leaving me, finding another, my daughter getting blind. How would people react, this white middle-aged man, you know, standing on stage? Now, the film has had its world premiere in Chukotka, which is on the other side of Alaska, but on the Russian side. And I had no idea how it would be received, but it was just enormous emotions again, just like here in Sweden. So I've been overwhelmed, and I, for 3 months I felt knackered, you know, too much emotion. You show all this from your life, which is such a good way. I've realized, be who you are, you know, tell people what you feel. How hard can it be? So that turned out a success, and I'm very happy that, you know, Kensington and Jeff, who's been like a small editor too, having opinions, that's been really important and supportive, and I feel like I'm very much, Kensington is part of my life. Even the first camel is named Kensington.
Wonderful.
So a bit about that. It's a emotional time now because so much is happening with these films and, you know, the situation we're in, people are watching more than ever. So for the films, obviously good, but, you know, frustrations due to the situation, as you well know. Wonderful. So you're in time.
Great. Thank you so much for the intro, Michael. So we're going to lead the Q&A to be pretty open. So the idea is to have people, as they want to ask a question, to unmute yourself, to turn on your video so we can have it more as a connected kind of dialogue here. And just kind of feel free to turn off or turn on your mic and go ahead and ask any questions you want. As I mentioned in the email invites, there aren't any topics that are off the table. So feel free to ask Michael on anything that you want. And I'll open it to the floor to you guys now.
Anything. Hi, love the films. I have a quick question about Man with a Pram. What, were you shocked by the class system coming into England? Because I mean, coming from there, it's something I'm very aware of. And I think it's something you highlighted really well, the difference as you were traveling through from Manchester down. Did you know it was going to be so wide?
Well, I'm kind of Anglophile because my sister, she was married in Britain for my first 11 years. So we used to go there every second or third year when the family could afford it. So I had a bit of an idea, but the odd thing that all my friends that I've made the last years due to exploration and traveling, so-called explorers. So when I went there, I have built this image that I thought that all Brits had this enormous ability to talk and to socialize and to have, especially with self-confidence. And then, of course, I end up in Moss Side, which is a rough neighborhood, which I loved, actually, because it's, you have everything there. It's just that there's no trees, nothing like that, not a lot of it around. So then it turns out that all these, my friends were also public school, private school, wealthy, from a wealthy background. I had no idea. Because I realized something was wrong because all these other Brits I met were, you know, pretty much like me, trying to figure out who in earth are we. So that was interesting. And the more I traveled, of course, I realized the enormous divisions and how good the Brits are selling themselves. We really believe this is a country which is so full of richness and fortune. And I fear what is happening now, because it was bad then. And I can imagine people in Moss Sinai having almost 5-6 million people not getting more than one meal a day. I'm worried. But do you read about it? No. So, you know, that's it. I would like to return back now post-Brexit and post the virus, whenever this will be, to do a similar trip to see what has happened. That's one of the ideas. But I also miss the UK, because it has a lot of these subcultures, the boating people and punk rockers, and we just don't have that in Sweden, where we all pretty much look the same. So I miss that liveliness. Long answer for a short question, I know, but I'm full of words today.
No, that's great. Thank you. And I'm sure you miss the pubs, because I miss the pubs.
Well, that's a really interesting thing with the pubs is, when you lived in Moss Side in my neighborhood, the only way for me to be able to get to talk to people was that I had to go to the local pub. It was only one left. One of the roughest pubs, apparently, I read on the internet in Britain. And it was a Manchester City pub as well, and they never knew I was a Manchester United supporter. I never told them that. But when I got there, I kind of had to wait to be moved to get accepted, and it took me like 3 or 4 months to sit next to the guy who was some kind of they called him the little governor. And when I got his kind of, got along with him, then Moss Side opened up much better. So that was really interesting. So, but it had changed a lot. You know, it used to be 20 pubs down the road, and it's only one left now, because it's such a big Muslim population who has moved in, and of course they don't drink. So I miss a lot of Britain, maybe even the pub. More questions. Leanne, I'm sure you have 3.
Mikhail, I was wondering, from the first film, the one in Yemen, I think your statement was that you were starting this journey, or maybe it was even before that trip, I'm not sure. It was about the meaning of life. You wanted to kind of go out and on that quest to understand. And where, you know, so I'm not sure how many years ago that was versus today. Do you believe, like, you know, the exploration that you've done in these trips have given you more clarity?
About the meaning of life, you mean?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I would say it's one life before the girls and another life after the girls. Now, of course, I'm still, you know, my drive is to figure out what do people think about life, meeting people, trying to understand who we are. But nowadays, you know, a lot of it is taken over by the girls, what they want and how they see life. And the older they get much more perspective on it and ask different questions. So the good thing with this situation we're in now is that we have so much time together. So we spend a lot of time watching movies and stuff, things I've never really had the time to do in a proper way. But now we have it, and I suddenly realized, wow, these guys, they know a lot of things I didn't know that. So that's been good. So now my thought for the next film is kind of, what will the future be for my daughters? So I would like to set off somewhere, and what is out there? And if this continues, of course, for a few months, you know, the economics and everything will be completely different for most people. So I'd like to see what's behind there after that, together with the girls somehow. See, that's the idea. So yes, I'm kind of letting them lead the way.
And they enjoy being part of the film experience and being on that side of the camera, Mikhail. Like, that just seems to be part of how they've been brought up. So they're very comfortable with that and sharing.
Well, it's like two complete, I can hear they are outside the door listening here now. There are two completely different girls in front of the camera and not in front of it. Very shy, silent, not on. Once the camera comes on, they kind of become different. But that was the hard thing doing the Greenland thing, you know, to get people to be, so that I had the camera out there 24 hours a day. And one reason my marriage went wrong, it was the camera, of course. It was always there. So, but that's how you also get a film. The idea was to get the viewer to feel that you're actually sitting in the same room as us, being part of it. And so, but it has a price, of course. So I was really worried, how would they react to the film when we sat down? But the only thing they said, they loved themselves, of course. But and they didn't like when they were arguing at that stage, but they live with that. So Eva said, she's 9 years old. It's fine with me. The only thing I was worried about, she said, was that you and mum would kiss on camera. So she actually thought it was much better that we didn't get along at all than that we start kissing on camera. So that's how she looked at it. So different. So, you know, see what they think. It's become part of their life, and they have only had good things coming out of what happened after the film so far. Something which worried me a lot too, but unnecessary worries. So one day at a time, see what they think. But you know, they are such a big part of my life, so I have a feeling I will try to. Ask them if we can go on. We'll see.
Well, and it's wonderful to see the progression of the two different movies that they were both in and see how they're growing. And certainly I'm sure anybody that's on this call today will enjoy, you know, look forward to the next, to see the next part of the journey as they continue to get older. Thank you, Mikhail.
Thank you. Well, the good thing with all this traveling is, look at the girls. You know, they are exactly as they are on camera. You know, comfortable. They get along so well. A godsend. So far, no problem at all, except the eye. You know, these the eyes and all this, but that's something else, of course. Amanda, do you have a question?
I am just listening away. Unfortunately, I didn't have the time to watch all three of the films, but I watched the Yemen one and was just spellbound by it. Like, what a journey you had.
Well, you know, it was I read today that the bombing has stopped in Yemen now due to the corona. So at least something good with that. But otherwise the situation there has of course gotten worse. And I don't know what Kensington the camel is doing today. I'm sure it's fine. I would like to go back too, of course. I want to go back to all the places I've been to see how things are. But vamos a ver, we'll see.
Did you ever stay in touch with the woman that you went through Yemen with, Michael?
Tanya, you mean? Do you mean Tanya, Jeff?
Yes.
Yes, well, the Yemen film came out again on SVT, so of course she got back into some kind of attention. And I don't know what happened. I've tried to get through to her, and she's starting a film career. So she's at a prestigious Swedish film school, which I feel is sad because then she will become like everybody else. But she is a strong character as always, and I try to be in touch with often, but she is just Tanya. Sometimes she's in touch and sometimes she's like she's dead. She's just a character. Right now she seems to be dead again, but she'll be back. Wonderful person. Marianne, any questions?
Hi, Michael.
Hello there.
I wanted to ask about Man with a Camel, which was really great. I'm actually a Dresden theme today. Pulled this out for the festival. Where I grew up in Jordan, we have our own Bedouins. So it's really interesting to see a little bit of insight into Yemeni Bedouins. And when I was growing up, we were always told that the Bedouins are kind of the police of the desert. So anytime we were around Petra, we had to be really respectful to the culture because that was their land. Did you find that it was kind of similar in Yemen?
Yeah, well, Yemen is kind of like, if you look at how people came in from Africa, they first came through, it is said, possibly over the strait into Yemen. So they are still, if you compare it to Jordan, for example, way more tribal all over. The whole north is just tribal groups in a complete mess, but interesting. And that's why they're holding on. So when the Saudis went to attack them for war, I almost smiled at themselves, at myself, and I thought, how are they going to be a people who's been in war for 5,000 years? And they haven't, they will not. And these tribes, they are like a society outside the normal, so state, and it runs very well. The South is a bit different. It used to be very communist. It's a bit looser. And the East, where I travel, that's where the Bedouin is. And they are very strict, exactly as you said. This is my area, that is, and they police. Do you remember this guy who kind of drew this invisible line? This is where it ends. It's like that. Mm-hmm. But it was something fantastic with them is that, you know, if they trust you, you have their trust. Mm-hmm. Wonderful people too,
sure.
Of course. But more like the Jordan Bedou than the tribal.
Mm-hmm. I think it really helps we don't have much conflict in Jordan for them to tribalize as much as there is in Yemen.
Well, yeah, well, different political situation too, somewhat.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, my pleasure, my pleasure. What is this then? Here's a question. Do you see that too, Madeleine, or is it only me who see this chat?
I think that might be a direct question to you. So you can read it out there if there's a question in the chat.
How do you balance between being a parent and still follow your explorer spirit? Do you feel you need to compromise the explorer Michael in order to be dead Michael and vice versa? Well, it's not the easiest thing in life, but so that's why I did Greenland. You know, they became part of me being able to continue with my life. And they, you know, was it right or wrong to do? I had a lot of these thoughts before bringing the whole family to Greenland. As I look at it today, when I see it, these two wonderful girls, how they turn out. Eva and Anna, you want to come and say quickly hello? So come down, here they come. They've been listening on the phone. So this is Dana.
Hi.
Eva.
Hi, ladies.
Are you going to say anything?
No.
Be careful with that Play-Doh, right? So Dana, she has Play-Doh all over the house. So it's this heavy smell of Play-Doh. I'll charge it. And then I'm also in charge of charging all the iPads, so they have things to do. No, so It's been much easier than I thought to be both explorer and dad at the same time due to bringing them with me. So, I think they've just accepted that their dad and their mom are two quite different people to other parents of their friends at school. And right now they are proud over us. How it will be in 10 years, maybe they will be writing books about us. We don't know. But it feels like we've taken a really good, to have these self-confident, kind, warm, easygoing kids, do take them traveling for sure. I see. And they, you know, they, what they are good at is like Jeff, who's a missionary kid, they kind of fit in quickly everywhere because they are so used to be moved around all the time. New schools, new places, not a problem. It's just another thing that they know from before. So far, so good.
I have another question. Greenland, what was the appeal? Why did you want to go down? I mean, it really did seem like you kind of fell in love with the country, especially it's quite an extreme place to live, but I know it was beautiful, but what were the pros and cons that really kind of made you fall in love with it?
So for years, I've been kind of up until Greenland looking for a place that I could, you know, where I would, this is home. And I did this journey by ski and canoe. I'm translating the film now to send to you. And it's this Siberian journey, which kind of made my life, I would say. So I spent a year in Siberia traveling down a river called the Kolyme. And it's one of the coldest inhabited places on earth. And I just fell in love with the people there. It was the best people I've ever met. Opened their homes, generous, warm, interesting. Everyone seemed to have a story. I was talking to another person today who asked me, you know, how were people like if you compare them to Greenlanders? Well, the Russians and the native Russians, say whatever you want about the Soviet era, but they were all culturally educated. So they read books like Pushkin, Dostoevsky. So when you came to meet these people, may they live in a reindeer cot or in a log cabin, they could talk and discuss everything, you know, the most interesting of subjects. And they all had such an interesting life story. So I was kind of looking for something similar, and I knew us moving to Siberia, impossible. So we kind of looked around the world. Pam, she grew up most of her life in Regina, and in Saskatchewan. So we were kind of looking for something similar, but which still would be on my list of, I need to understand the North, the Arctic area. So obviously Greenland is such a massive part there. And, you know, of course, I've seen the photos, and it's easy to make the native people being exotic, you know, the Inuit, they run around killing, you know, polar bears hunting in skins. And, you know, though I'm used to avoiding these things, I had this, maybe it's exactly like Siberia, but with a Scandinavian touch. And it took such a long time to find a place to live. So we went to Nuuk first, or Pam, she went to the university there. And it was a bit of a shock because honestly, I've never been to a more unfriendly place than Nuuk. And I thought, what is going on? What is going on? But then we met the last 2 weeks, a guy who came from Kasianwit, and he said, this is the place for you. It's mountain. It's the only place in Greenland where you actually can get beyond the mountains, because most other places are kind of so isolated. So you only have the sea and it's almost impossible to get on the other side where you have the inland ice. So, and when we came to Kasiang with it, extraordinary, beautiful, wonderful in every way. But the Greenlanders were very different to the Siberians. They've been ruined by Scandinavian colonialism. That is the only reason I can see, because they are different to the Canadian Inuit that I've met. And they're very hard to get to know, and they are suspicious of foreigners and people coming in from the outside. So it took a long time until everything went wrong. And then suddenly we kind of became part of their lives too. We were just not these two wealthy people from Sweden who came there. Suddenly we turned out to be like everybody else, same problems, same mistakes. But then Eva's eyes was so, you know, I was scared that she would be blind for forever. So we took the decision I would return back home with the girls and Pam would stay and figure out life. And she's still there today. She's in a place called Umanak, very far north, and trying to still figure out life. So, of course I miss Greenland. I miss the wilderness. I miss the fresh air and this feeling that you can just go on with no end. There's nothing except you and a huge ice cap. But it was a tough trip. And I went back to Siberia 3 weeks ago to pick up a prize for the Greenland film. They loved the Greenland film for me. You know, they kept, because situation was in Anadir, is another place where you can only fly in and come by boat. And the people who live there are Chukchi. So they call themselves Eskimos. And, you know, they are very, used to go back and forth to Alaska. So same kind of people. So it was 200 Chukchi and Russians when the film started. And afterwards they were crying and they were hugging and kissing. I was in shock. I was crying on stage, because for the Russians, so they've come from the western part of Russia and ended up in exactly the same situation as we ended up in Greenland, in complete isolation, and they were freaking out. And here comes these guys to say, this is normal, it's nothing wrong with you. So many of these people who cried and hugged, they just wanted to say, thank you, now we see why we feel so uncomfortable here. It just takes time. On the other side, it was so good to meet the Chukchi, because for them it was interesting to see the Greenlanders, who they couldn't really understand either. But I came back to this part of the world to see that the Siberians are still incredibly, overwhelmingly warm and kind. So that was good, really good. So I'd love to go back for sure. There too. So Bo, do you have a question? No? Do ask questions. I feel really honored, very happy to sit here and talk to you. This is incredible what you can do in these times. For sure.
Mikhail, I'll ask another question if you don't mind.
Of course.
I noticed on, which was, I really enjoyed actually, when Maddie sent out the booking for today, she had a little bit of a clip that you did as an introduction to today. When I saw you, which, because it's been a while since I've seen you, but when I saw you on the video, I would say that how you look today versus the times that you were in the different movies, you look different, because it looks like you've lost weight or what have you. Is there something that, and I noticed on Instagram, you've got some different diet related things going on. Is that purposeful? Is it working well?
Well, I was trying to figure out the next expedition. Generally, when you've done a film and it's been on TV and it has had its premiere, then you have about 6 months to come up with a good idea, because before you're considered forgotten. So basically, I knew I need to have an idea on board 6 months after the film premiere, which I knew would be mid-February. So then I start thinking what to do, and age came up, and I start getting injured from all my training. And I couldn't understand why, because I used to shake it off like nothing before. And then I realized I'm just getting old. And I thought, I don't like it. Surely there must be a way to navigate around age. So then I start reading up on what is happening. A lot of it is done in Silicon Valley, and because the baby boomers who kind of run the world economically, they don't want to die either. So they put a lot of money into it, and I got fascinated by everything from these watches, rings which measure your sleep, and how to, there are so different ways to train, and especially when you go over 40, there are certain ideas today how to train. It's not like before, it has changed a lot. So you basically, you know, just a small thing, you don't run more than every 3-4 days. Before, you could just do it because your body cannot take it. It less and less. And then sleep and food got more important. So I got more involved in that than I found this Polish dietist who does diet for ultra runners and explorers. And I thought that sounds good. So I've tried that for 6 months. And of course, you know, once you start doing that, eat proper food, you lose weight. You know, 7 kilos just in 6 weeks. So she had to rewrite it. So, you know, at least I would have nothing, a bit left, because you need fat when you travel. Or at least I thought before, that's dead idea too, by the way. But it's always been returning to the north, and I really wanted to ski to the North Pole and cross it to the other side, just to prove that age has nothing to do with it. It's just intelligence, how to plan it. So it's all part of this. So I started to look, food, sleep is the most important of all. 6-8 hours is a must for your body to recover and not get injured or ill. And then try all these things, yoga, cold baths. I've been around doing that, and it's really nice. But now with the corona, it was like a wake up, just do what you've always done. So I'll stick with the sleep and the diet and the training. And see what happens now. I think it's a sign that I should be looking for other things. So I know people are finding different ways to pursue their lives, people who live in tiny houses, people who, you know, live out in big cities but still live like they are living in a big garden. And I'm beginning to find that fascinating. So we'll see. But I will keep that training just to see how technically you can manipulate your genes to become 120 years old, according to Silicon Valley. Who knows?
Yeah. Thank you.
So that's how my thoughts go. Of course, I'm a freak. When you get an idea, it sticks. But then things change, and you're just like with the corona, you rethink. First, it's a shock, and then you just look at it factually and then deal with it. So initially with the corona, I was in shock, complete shock. Woke up in the morning, just felt this heavy darkness. What is happening? So what I did, I stopped reading the news, even though it's part of my work, because it just drives you insane. And then if it's something bad, I will hear it anyway somewhere. Then I just don't read it. And what a difference in sleep and life. I have to say that. Here's a question. Will we be getting an English subtitle version of the Siberian film? Yes. It just takes a bit longer now during the corona times, but 3 or 4 weeks. And then here's a question from Bo to everyone. I have a question regarding the future of travel and how the next generation of travelers will need the tools to better understand the destination they will be visiting and how to be more inclusive with communities, environment, climate, and be more informed on global health and education. Considering your children learn through real life experiences, do you have any insight in this based on your own experience through the expeditions you embarked on? Well, now that's a tough question. I think you guys can answer that much better than me. But of course, it depends on how long it will continue. If it's over in a month or two more, I think we'll go back pretty much to like it was before. If it continues and run down the economy of most countries, we will have to look at different ways to travel. However, what I've noticed on people around me is that if they haven't traveled before, they've realized they will travel. They've suddenly realized this is how fast it can change and end, and they've done nothing. I've seen that from questions or comments that I get now from the fields. I don't meet any people, so I don't know what they think, but from other comments. But I think you're on a good way there already, of course. So where are you, Bo, now? Bo left.
Toronto. I'm in Toronto.
Yeah, it says Toronto. All right.
I was just asking because in terms of preparing future travelers to destinations where it's important to be informed about, you know, like the education level in certain communities, especially when you're visiting more remote areas. What are your insights based on seeing your children learn through these real life experiences and not being in a classroom setting? What do you think was beneficial in the way that they saw their perspective of the areas that you visited with them?
Well, so during this year in Greenland, of course, the education there was almost non-existent. Eva, first day she started in class 1, second day class 2, third day class 3. That's how fast it went where she was on an educational level when she arrived. And then she got ill, so no school for almost a whole year, and we came back. She goes to an English school here in Malmö. Pam, she's an academic and she's tough on this educational thing. And it took them half a year to catch up with their friends. But of course, what they bring with them, they've learned so much more and they are comfortable with new settings. And they, at least Eva, is very concentrated. Dana, she doesn't really care at all, which is fine. So my idea, I would like to take them with me on another trip on bicycle through Sweden. And Eva, she said immediately, what about school? And I said, you learn honestly more here in a couple of weeks than you would do in a few months there. And you will always catch up. I think the educational thing, it's tough. But we'll see what happens. I know they've learned a lot, but most of all is that they are warm, very kind, very respectful young ladies who are a lot of fun to be together. And I think that has very much to do with all the traveling. For them, it doesn't matter what people look or what they say or anything. They just move in and out. And that's why we put them in an international school here too. how it is.
So do you think that that way of education is a good kind of fundamental base for, I would say, the future leaders in being able to promote that way of style of travel as well, in the sense that, the tools that your kids learn being in an international school, you're not really being taught in a classroom setting where you're being lectured, but you're rather learning through hands-on experiences and seeing how travel really benefits people in the community as well, but also the visitors themselves having learned in a different environment. Do you think that that's where am I getting with this?
No, I understand. What I can see though is that school has changed a lot since I went to school, which is like 190 years ago. Mm-hmm. Today, the kids, they actually get a project, like say it may be architecture. I hadn't even heard that word before I turned 23. Now they start, you know, constructing themselves, and they spend a whole week more or less doing that, and they involve some mathematics and whatever, and I kind of like that. They've definitely moved on further than the way I remember school, and then it's up to the kids. Eva, she's like a mother, an academic, so for her, she gets everything immediately. Dana, she's like me, she's bored after 2 seconds if it's not good enough and prefer to do other things. Mm-hmm. She does other things though. Mm-hmm. So she's a tougher challenge, but she's streetwise, so she will survive.
Okay.
Not worried about that. So I think, you know, very hard question. Some people, you know, why is this happening? I have this favorite philosopher called Slavoj Žižek. He's from Slovenia, and he kind of thinks this is a time for us to figure things out, and I'm kind of, he could well be right. It depends on how long it goes on for. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you for such a good question. Wow, we have a whole team here. I wanted to ask a couple of light questions. What are the 3 things you cannot travel without? That's a very good question. This is horrible to answer, but I guess the phone. And I need to think about that. That's over the. That's three. A lot of things for me. Yeah. Well, at least I found that, and I guess I'll get back to you. What are the 3 things? No. What is the weirdest food you have tried? Oh, I've tried a lot. I think all these extraordinary palm grubs that I was eating through Congo Kinshasa. Did you ever get that over at your place, Jeff? The palm grubs? So that was probably the most weird, but I've had quite a lot of different stuff. Another one in Greenland is rotten intestines, smells horribly, tastes quite good. But I felt really bad after that. So, you know, you need a bit of time to get used to that. And besides Eva's eye complication, question 3, what was the scariest moment you faced while traveling, cold or heat? All extremes are the same. The only advantage with cold is that you can always get liquid from ice and snow, which you cannot get in heat. So that you get a situation in the desert and heat, it's hard and you can't find water, that's it. In the Arctic, you can always survive on what you find there. And there's been, you know, the scariest moments, of course, are when you lose concentration, which is normally at the end of the trip when you're tired. So most accidents on climbing and all this, they happen when, just at the end when you relax. Yeah. Last question. Do you have any silly, funny stories to share about travels? Well, humor, of course, is extremely, extremely important. I don't think I would have been able to survive all this time if I didn't have some kind of a humor. And I've realized most people that I really enjoy have a lot of humor, and you need humor because you get into so many complicated situations and you do so many mistakes all the time. So you just have to have the ability to laugh. But of course, one time I was in serious trouble because I did a mistake, and this, it has to do with the poo and all these things. If you think that is horrible, don't listen. But in Siberia, when it's 50 to minus 60, very few people have toilets indoors. So if you live in a community or a town, you have outdoor toilets. And you have a central toilet, and then you have a few who are kind of located all over this town. And in a place called Srednikolimsk, they had a very high toilet, and I didn't understand why until one day I went there. And so first you had to climb like 3 meters up this toilet on stairs. And once you got up there, because it's completely dark, of course, during winter, so you see nothing, you just have your torch. And then I saw these big Eiffel Tower thing sticking up through the hole, and then I realized it was just frozen shit. So what has happened is, of course, when it's 60 and you take a dump, it freezes. So it all collected up, so you had this beautiful 3 meter high Eiffel Tower of shit. So next day I met the governor of the village in Bieli Dom, the White House, they call it, oddly enough. And he came in and he was so happy. We were happy, me and Johan. And he said, how do you find life here? So I decided I'll do one of my jokes. So I took this with the toilet. And he got so offended and upset. And he said, all these things we've helped you with, and all you have to say and that you learned is shit. He was so upset, so he didn't look at us the whole time we were there. He was just looking down. And we were forced to meet him 2 or 3 times to thank him and to for his assistance on our next leg of the journey. So these are my worst joke. And I won't do it again. So if you, I just realized an hour, we've been sitting here an hour, guys. So if you have any more questions or something, because the problem for me now are these girls who are on the door all the time, and it's dinner time. And they want the same food every day. It's pasta with cheese sauce with sausage. And now, since I have become, I don't eat meat anymore if it's not wild food like muskox or whale or seal or something like that. So I try to persuade them not to eat it, but they want it. What to do? So they eat the same 3 times a day. Don't tell Pam, their mother. When she asks me, I give her all these meals that they are eating, but then she asks them and they agree with me. So far, so good.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for joining us for this hour for the Q&A, Michael. And thank you everyone for joining. If you guys want to follow along with Michael a little bit more, you can follow him on Instagram at Explorer Global. And he does also have a website, which is michaelstrandberg.com. if you want to keep in touch with him that way. And yeah, thank you guys again so much for joining. Michael, any last words? Go for it.
Yeah, very happy to have talked to you. Very happy to have been here. And if there's anything, any question, do not hesitate to ask. I'm very happy to answer. And it's been wonderful to, for me, this is a highlight of life, just to see all these people in front of you this way. And that, I think it gives so much hope. Even in this situation, we can still communicate. Okay, it's not physically, but we are not supposed to be physical anyway, are we? So this is, it still is being part of a community and a group. I think it's wonderful.
So yes, it was wonderful, wonderful. Thank you.
So take care now and hope to see you soon.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Thanks so much, everyone. Thanks, Michael. Thank you. Enjoy so your much. Dinner.
Bye.
Thank you, Michael. Bye.
Bye. Hugs to the girls.
I will. Thank you. Ciao.
Ciao.